Pleasure to be here. It's always wonderful to have an excuse to come back to campus. I love my time here, so yeah, any excuse is good. Thanks for the introduction. I should make one quick correction. The Accel India team, you know, we're a team of six people, five based in India, and I'm sort of the lone joker here. And you know, we'll talk a bit about that. So maybe first, just very quickly about Accel. So we're a family of funds focused on different geographies. So we have the US-based funds, which have been operating now for about 30-plus years. We also have UK-based funds, which now invest across Europe, as well as Russia, Turkey. And then the most sort of recent in the family is sort of the India funds, where we've been active now for about 7 years. I joined the firm about 4 years ago, but prior to that, been a long time Valley person, part entrepreneur, part large companies. So let's jump in, and you know, very informal. So please, you know, chime in, and of course we'll have a lot of opportunity to chat more as well. But for those of you who've sort of looked at any of the followed the sort of news recently, one of the things that you might have noticed is venture sort of capital in India really sort of grew quite dramatically. Now it's not that venture capital is the only metric for entrepreneurship, but it's a reasonable proxy and obviously the one that I'm most familiar with. But you can see, you know, there was sort of this very gentle trend, and then suddenly into 2014, it sort of just went sort of off the charts. 2015 was a pretty busy year as well.
Can I ask, what's the unit?
So these are that's about 8 billion up there. Sorry, yeah, I think I chopped that. But there's about 8 billion that went in last year.
Dollars?
$8 billion. Yes.
Wow. Okay.
And this is I mean, obviously, you know, it's still small compared to what we see here, but obviously, you know, both, I mean, in India the value of a dollar is much bigger as well. But these are early promising signs. 2016 will almost. We'll get into that. It's almost certain that 2016 is actually going to be a bit slower, and we can talk about that as well. But yeah. So why, you know, so what happened, right? Why this sudden, you know, sort of rush at that time, and. You know, if you had to boil it down into a single thing, it really is sort of it's the mobile story, right? So this is really about finally the country coming online. So if you look at landline-based internet penetration, you know, that started in India, you know, more than a couple of decades ago. But if you looked at that sort of, you know, trend line of how many people got connected, you know, it would kind of, you know, start way back here, but it would kind of, you know, barely be here, right? So that was the number of people that were really getting connected to the internet using sort of traditional connections. Mobile phones, you know, really started growing in India. Price points were very, very. Very low. The voice tariffs were very low. So if you look at sort of the early part of this decade, you know, we really had phenomenal amounts of phone penetration, and this is largely you know, basic mobile phones, very basic feature phones.
So did the total number of mobile phones actually drop from 2011 to 2012?
Probably did. A bunch of things have happened, right? At one point, people used to start, you know, they would get multiple cell phones, and there was no notion. I have to double check on that, but one of the big things that did happen was the whole notion of attaching a phone to an identity. Right. So you were no longer allowed to just sort of buy phones, and it's quite likely that that's it. But good point. So phones become a lot more accessible. You know, we start getting smartphones as well. That little sort of green sliver that starts growing is really smartphone penetration. 2012, you know, close to 70 million smartphones sold, but by most measures, way less than half actually ever got connected to the net. So this was, you know, an aspirational, cool product to buy. You know, people started buying it, but it was still not being used quite as much, right? So so less than half actually ever got a data connection, even though it was a smartphone. But because we got to the point where there were enough buyers, prices on those smartphones started dropping. 2013, we sort of hit this inflection point where the smartphone really fell below the 5,000 rupee mark in India, and that's roughly $100 now, a bit less, and that sort of slab has always been a pretty you know, good transition point for the best models below that to sort of grow. So in 2014, we suddenly have 170 million smartphones that are being acquired now. Between 2013 and 2014, we now had already more than 5x of the folks that had ever gotten onto the internet using sort of landline connectivity. 2014, one other thing sort of, you know, played into this a bit, but at least from the venture capital perspective, there was a new government that came in. This was the Modi government. Government in India has been traditionally not massively sort of supportive of you know, the startup ecosystem, a bunch of other things as well. This was the first time we actually had a government that had a clear majority. We had some leadership that had shown sort of strong sort of signs of being progressive in the past. 2014, we also had a couple of years of where globally the number of places where people could really sort of get a good return on their money was abysmally small. So I think it was really kind of this confluence of three things, but primarily the fact that India was finally getting connected, the fact that people anticipated several years of a reasonably helpful government, and at least certainly not one that would create new unforeseen hurdles, and the fact that anybody managing a large pool of global money started thinking about India as a possible place to have exposure. So that's really what suddenly drives that whole influx of capital and that sort of steep rise that we saw in 2014 and 2015.
Investment in infrastructure to allow attachment?
No. So the Modi government was essentially seen as one that would, in the best case, be very benevolent to supporting infrastructure, connectivity, and in the worst case, would not be a detriment, right? I mean, they wouldn't create new laws that, you know, in order to appease a certain vote bank, might suddenly create a big capitalist, you know, sort of hurdle, right, for a bunch, and unfortunately, you know, I mean, that's been the case in the past. So it wasn't counting on the fact that the government is going to make dramatic improvements, but it really was the first time that we knew that there was a predictably stable government for a little while. I mean, one quick aside: the Indian government over the last prior to this has always been, it's never been a clear single party. So India is a multi-party structure. It's never been a single party that had the clear majority. Because of that, you would always have a few parties that would have to get together, form a coalition to form the government. But that always meant ongoing friction, right? Because at any point of time, one of the camps had leverage to get something done because they'll say, hey, otherwise I'm going to drop out of this coalition. And that's always been a bit of a, you know, hurdle. So that was really the viewpoint at that point, that this was going to be a relatively stable government.
Correction, only last 20 months.
Sorry.
You always had a majority.
Right, sure, fair enough. So just again, a few small factoids. So in 2014, every single day, there was three new phone models, right? So this is, I mean, that's how much attention the market suddenly started getting. What this allowed then was, so this is a data point from a company called Flipkart, where now, because, especially if you look at tier two cities in India, The ability for somebody to actually on their phone discover that, you know, for my size, there's actually 40 shoes that I can choose from. And I can actually order them and they'll actually get delivered. I mean, one thing to remember is that, I mean, if you think about Amazon here, Amazon effectively had to compete with Walmart very aggressively, right? For the most of the US, you have very rich product availability within a relatively short drive. I mean, in India, that's not the case. I mean, we've never had organized retail at that scale. And so for a lot of these buyers, I mean, they simply never had as much product choice. So in some ways, you know, one could argue that the e-commerce opportunity in India is really not just sort of the Amazon opportunity, right? It's really the Amazon plus Walmart opportunity from the get-go. And you will actually see that theme in several other verticals where there really hasn't been sort of strong offline organized players. I mean, not in all, but in several verticals, you haven't had those. And therefore, the online opportunity is, again, really sort of much bigger. This is actually one of the things that, that the government did enable. And so there are lots of subsidies within the government structure. By most measures, people claim that, you know, less than half actually gets to the person that the subsidy was intended for. One of the things that the government has been doing is really trying to move most of that subsidy infrastructure onto a strong ID-based infrastructure that ties up to your mobile phone. So effectively now, what's happening is a lot of these folks that never had bank accounts, the only way that they get their subsidy is by effectively sort of a wallet that now lives on their phone, and they can now walk into banks and use that to actually get the cash. So just by virtue of that, you know, we suddenly have a phenomenal number of folks in India that are now, without even effectively knowing it, are really becoming mobile wallet users. And over time, this starts presenting great opportunities for other folks to build upon. I mean, just in terms of, you know, sort of the demographic dividend that the country has, the fact that this is going to become one of the largest, I mean, you know, largest workforces in the world, that automatically creates a lot of opportunity. The fact that a lot of this workforce will really be using the mobile phone as their primary way to get work done. That creates, you know, new kinds of opportunities that, in fact, we might not have quite tapped in here, where knowledge workers on this landscape typically have had desktops and laptops and other ways to get work done. And, you know, some of this has sort of started translating into how sort of young people in India are feeling about their prospects. It also helps in terms of, you know, to the extent that they have disposable income, how they're choosing to spend that. Yeah, you know, we touched a bit about this. One of the other initiatives being launched is this whole notion of how a lot of government buying is now going to try and get, I think what they're trying to push for is that at least 20% of the purchases will have to be made from a local manufacturer if one exists. So again, now that starts creating the right kinds of incentives for people to get into building things for that market. And this is really the momentum that we're now seeing. So there's 1,000 companies every year every quarter that are now getting some kind of funding to actually start a new business. And this is sort of the whole rise of this broad entrepreneurial momentum that obviously we're very bullish upon and we're participating in. So very quickly about us, the team in India has been investing for about 10 years now. We manage close to $500 million for the India portfolio. Over these years, we've now invested in over 100 companies. We're fundamentally a very early stage investor, so most of our investments tend to be really the first money that goes into a company. Just for quick comparison, I think globally this number is about 800 or so companies active across our portfolio. This is a bit under $4 billion across the various funds, and as I mentioned, about 30 plus years of overall investing. So you know, just to again, ours is one sort of view into this landscape, right? And there are active investors that that are investing in much broader sort of areas as well. Our focus tends to be a lot more technology-led companies. So for us, the three primary areas that we're the most active in, the first is really the fact that we do now have a consumer that's getting connected. And because of that, there are lots of opportunities that open up. You know, the simplest ones tend to be sort of early on are you know, e-commerce. But then, you know, once e-commerce starts sort of happening, and today we have platforms like Flipkart and Snapdeal and Paytm that are pretty active in India, and we have Amazon, which is aggressively active in India as well, trying to make sure that they're a very relevant e-commerce player in that market. But once these platforms start falling into place, other things, right? So for instance, today a lot of e-commerce in India has to be done using COD. So this is cash on delivery. Because the whole ecosystem there is still not quite wired up to actually make online payments. And even the small subset of people that can make online payments, many of them even have sort of trust issues, right, with using a payment mechanism that they're not very comfortable with. And so the bulk of e-commerce in India, the way it really happens is I order something, I don't pay a dime for it, and the same day or the next day or a couple of days later, somebody shows up with a package. And then I look at the package, I open it up, and then I actually hand over cash to that person who delivered the package. And if you think about the ramifications of that, right? I mean, in many ways, Amazon for many years was essentially sort of a float business, right? I mean, the fact that, you know, I grab money from you right away, and then you know, I send you the product, and I didn't pay my suppliers for a couple of months. I mean, in India, it was very, very different. Other challenges, the delivery network. So it turned out that when we're investors in Flipkart, which today is the largest e-commerce platform there. When the delivery folks go out, depending on what they delivered, they might actually have collected a fair bit of cash. There isn't a strong notion of identity in India as well. And so what would happen is, very often, these delivery folks would actually disappear. So they made a bunch of deliveries, they had a bunch of cash, and they'd just gone off the network. And so Flipkart, for a while, tried to work with the existing logistics companies in India, and you know, they just couldn't get them to move as fast to do the kinds of things that they wanted. And so eventually, Flipkart at some point said, you know what, I'm going to have to be a UPS as well. And so Flipkart today runs the largest delivery network in India, and had to build it from scratch. And you know, colleagues of mine who were on the board were saying, oh my God, what are we doing? You know, are you insane? And thankfully, they didn't listen to the board. But those were the kinds of challenges. And that's partly why it wasn't a slam dunk for somebody like an Amazon, or for those of you who are familiar with the Rocket, the Somer brothers, you know, for them to kind of very easily come in and just replicate a model. I mean, there was a lot of this hard work that had to be done to sort of make that work. But so today, if you think about it, payments, logistics, right? A lot of these are they're not really solved pain points, and so there's a lot of entrepreneurial activity trying to address these kinds of things. So this is really, I mean, one big theme for us, and in our case, it's probably about 50% of our focus is all of the opportunities that arise from the fact that we now have a local consumer that is willing to transact online in some shape or form. The second piece, which is about 25-30% of our focus, is for those of you who are familiar with the Indian software industry, there are these large service companies that were created years ago. So you know, companies like Infosys and TCS, Cognizant, Wipro. These have really become large powerhouses that power the back office for a lot of global enterprises. But I think what happened was, because of that, India started India had this huge pool of competent software developers. But I think it didn't really accelerate into true innovative product teams. But what we've seen over the last 10, 12 years is, you know, when companies like Google and Facebook and LinkedIn, all of these sort of, you know, new age companies have set up large teams in India, we now have a new crop of folks that are working with some of the best product managers in the world. They're working with some of the most progressive teams in the world. And so suddenly we see this, not suddenly, but over the last few years, we see this sharp rise in that kind of a DNA, where it's not just about given a specification, I can build to it, but I can actually see and identify product opportunities. I can actually take a stab at going and building a product. And so for us, that's why, you know, we're very bullish about this particular theme as well. One piece that's related to that is also, if you look at, and I hinted at this a bit, but the sort of the mobile-first economy, right? I think a lot of what we've seen in terms of software for the enterprise has not really been mobile-first. But if you look at not just India, but all of the emerging markets, right? I mean, this is, you know, these are countries where a lot of work will get done through these smartphones. And it's an opportunity for a lot of solutions to be refactored. So, you know, on my laptop, I might be willing to work with some software that actually has a lot of features, and, you know, I'm switching through it. I'm doing sort of you know, complex workflows. When you're in a mobile-only world, what we're beginning to notice is that it tends to be much more broken down, right? And this is much more purpose-built stuff, and so to us, there's this opportunity for how software that powers these enterprises will actually get refactored and redone in a different way. One theme that's probably a bit unique to us is we're also seeing a lot of tech-led healthcare innovation in India. And that actually is both for the domestic market as well as the global market. And you know, we have a couple of examples, and we'll talk through that. But a couple of my colleagues in India are very, very active in that space. So, you know, just going to walk through sort of some, you know, some examples. In some cases, these are going to be, you know, very relatable to some counterpart that you might be familiar with. In some cases, you might notice something sort of unique about how it's being done. Book My Show started off as being the back office for movie theaters, where for a movie theater to be able to sell tickets, you know, they needed some basic software, and they, you know, did that for you know, very many years, and they built a small business you know, around it. And then when the smartphone took off, suddenly they had this opportunity to really unify all of these movie theaters into a single app on the front. Again, for those of you who knows, you know, Indians love their movies, right? And so there's a very high movie consumption in all kinds of languages. I think there are three languages that are each independently bigger than Hollywood. So Book My Show was a brilliant example of, you know, when the smartphone sort of penetration took off, it actually became one of the first apps that people, you know, as soon as I learned how to use apps, and then, you know, there were things like WhatsApp, which is very, very popular in India. But Book My Show would become one of the first apps that people would download. And in many cases, people wouldn't actually buy tickets on it, but they would use that as their information source, because it was just wonderful to be able to have all of that in one place, as opposed to going and running and sort of, you know, looking for a newspaper, which used to be the way people found out about which theater played which movie. One interesting thing they noticed was, you know, as I mentioned, not everybody is comfortable transacting online. You know, in fact, many people don't even have credit cards. But there'd be this interesting pattern where there's this one person that you know, had Book My Show, had connected their credit card, and in the first week of a movie, that one person might end up buying 120 tickets. because they were buying tickets for all of their friends. And so the friends were probably just paying them cash, but because they had the app, say, oh, you know, just yeah, buy me 5 tickets for the show. So, you know, you almost had these mini agents that were transacting for a small local community.
It's nice to get welcomed by Stanford.
Common floor, and then maybe I'll just talk about prop tiger together, right? So if you look about real estate transactions, you know, again, very active market, obviously in any large economy, but discovery, right? I mean, just information flows were fundamentally, and again, this goes back to the thing I was talking about. You know, the fact that there weren't that many large offline organized players, there was no notion of official MLS listing. There was no one large broker that would be able to tell you about 60% of the inventory. So it was a very, very fractured landscape. And so because of that, you know, you had the opportunity of both, you know, something that was more like a listings platform, just actually making information visible and available. And one where you could, in fact, become a broker that very quickly could become larger than any offline broker that that operated in the market. Flipkart, I already mentioned. Myntra was acquired by Flipkart. It remains a standalone brand. The fact that there is very little organized retail today, if I'm a global brand that wants to operate in India, you know, Nike shoes. I know that Indians love Nike shoes, and I want to make sure that there is great access to Nike shoes all across. I can't go in and do a deal with 2 or 3 retailers, offline retailers, and get good coverage. Because it's such a sort of fragmented landscape, I actually have to go and do lots and lots of deals. And you know, dealing with these companies is not the easiest. Information flows were often broken. Myntra started off by being a higher-end fashion portal. But because of that, it pretty much had access to the entire community across India that was willing to transact for higher-end inventory. Because of that, they were able to go to all of these global brands who hadn't really bothered setting up offline access in India. And Myntra was able to do lots of exclusive deals with them, where suddenly these brands had access to a market that they were interested in, and they had it through a single relationship that they were comfortable with. And that's one of the reasons why Flipkart, in spite of the acquisition, has kept that as a separate brand, because it really occupies a different mindset from a buyer's perspective. And then, of course, you know, we have to have the Uber category. Uber, you know, starts taking off. You know, we see sort of clones, you know, show up in all kinds of markets. Today, Ola is, I think by most measures, it's 2 to 3x the size of Uber in India. But again, this is a market where Uber is super aggressive, much like Amazon is in the e-commerce category. I have relatives who can't believe that they can do this, that they can whip out their phone and they can say, oh, I want a cab, and a cab shows up, right? I mean, again, I mean, there was, and if you look, you know, most of the organized taxi operators in India, I mean, the whole experience there was you know, horrible. You know, you would call, you'd be stuck in queues, they might accept something, and the cab doesn't show up. And so, I mean, this was really dramatic sort of improvement from what used to be the case. Collectability is an interesting one because, you know, most cultures are celebrity crazy, but I think there is crazy and then there is super crazy, right? And Indians love their celebrities, and if you look at a lot of advertisements that you might notice on billboards in India or on television ads, a lot of them tend to be celebrity led, and you know, celebrities really view this as they view their sort of status as a celebrity as a way to heavily monetize it while they are a celebrity. But most celebrities aren't happy with the kinds of endorsements that they end up doing. So Collectibilia was actually set up to go and create, and even if it's not necessarily create, but to really try and make sure that the kinds of endorsement opportunities that are created for the celebrity really fit the image of that celebrity. They fit the kind of audience that is most. So you know, it was almost a bit of a you know, think of it as a data-driven approach to creating endorsement opportunities. And one big unfair advantage they had starting was, and for those of you, there's a gentleman called Sachin Tendulkar. He's a cricket player, and there is, you know, I think other than kids less than 3 months old, you know, there probably isn't an Indian who hasn't heard of Sachin Tendulkar. But Sachin Tendulkar is actually one of the co-founders of the company, and that gave them this big advantage. You know, it attracted a lot of celebrities to come and work with that brand. Again, for the Indians in the crowd, if you're familiar with Virat Kohli, he's another celebrity cricketer. He has a brand called Wrong, which is spelled W-R-O-G-N. That was actually all created by Collectibilia for him. So you know, a bit of a unique model, you could say. CoverFox Insurance, again, this is very much leveraging the fact that there is no good organized offline insurance. In fact, most insurance, like for instance, auto insurance in India, it's fundamentally very, very archaic. You know, insurance is determined by what year and what model of a car you have, and pretty much nothing else. You know, it's got nothing to do with you know, the fact that, you know, you have a terrible record or a good record or anything else that could be inferred about you or about the condition of the car and so on. But CoverFox is a company that's really trying to go after that landscape. My smart comparison shopping, you know, that's again one of the ancillary things that you might sort of expect to start cropping up. Portia, again, a good example. So healthcare, you know, people get admitted to hospitals. At some point, they're discharged. Hospitals are now being held a lot more responsible for really fulfilling their post-discharge duties. But most of them don't really want to send their doctors and nurses, you know, scurrying around, following up on all of the things that they should be following up. What Portia does is it's a combination. So they actually buy that sort of business from the hospitals, or I mean, they provide that service to the hospitals, where they've built their own network of, you know, doctors and nurses and physiotherapists and so on. And so they get paid by the hospitals for doing that piece. But now, over that, they're building a very deep direct-to-consumer business as well. So now the fact that, and I actually did this for my mom as well. So I actually called them from here, and I set up an appointment for a doctor and then a physiotherapist to show up at home. But that's the opportunity that they're going after. And, you know, I guess you have to have a food delivery startup, so. Fab hotels, you know, again, very, very few large organized hotel players and lots of small fragmented players. And these smaller guys are having a hard time attracting you know, folks to come and stay. You know, each one is now worried about, well, how do I make sure that people can discover me online? The traditional model was, you know, I would just show up in a city, and then I would kind of ask around, and I'd walk up to a hotel, and I would, you know, sort of, you know, get a room. You know, as the world gets connected, a lot of these folks that don't invest in becoming discoverable are going to suffer. And so you have a small set of companies that are really focused on, you know, think of it as it's really sort of a franchise model that allows these smaller operators to gang up under a single brand. But now that brand makes all of their, you know, all of those sort of aggregate properties a lot more discoverable. And you know, folks doing various things in that spectrum. So for instance, in some cases, really trying to dictate a bit more of a uniform look and feel, and you know, what kinds of sheets and pillows and those kinds of things that sort of should be there, and then others that are much more loosely coupled. MoneyView, I think, is actually, again, a quick example that I'll talk about. But today, when you do any kind of financial transaction with your bank or the small set of people that do something with a credit card or a debit card, you are actually sent a text message with sort of the details about that transaction. And it turns out on Android phones, and India is predominantly an Android ecosystem, you can actually download an app and let that app look at all of your incoming texts. And so what MoneyView is, it's really an app that just comes in and looks at all of your texts, and from that point onwards, all of the new ones, and it builds a complete financial picture about you. So it's sort of like, I mean, if you think of what, again, for those of you who might have used a service like Mint, I mean, Mint had to do a lot of hard work, and they built it upon the work of this other company called Yodlee, but the whole secure interconnectivity on the back end to make sure that I could securely get information. I mean, in India, you have this sort of weird opportunity where I can just sort of sit on the client, and I can just wait for all that information to come to me, and I can sort of actually group it up on the phone. And so, yeah, again, a very, I mean, not an opportunity that, that you know, could really be executed in this market. Scriptbox, just a quick, traditionally, Indians have been savers, right? So, you get money, you find out ways in which you at least save a portion of it. And the saving ecosystem is fairly, I mean, the options are sort of overwhelming. I live this, through this. I mean, my dad had all kinds of things that he would use to save bits and pieces of money all over. So now you have this generation of folks that have, I mean, they want to save. You know, they've grown up in environments where they know the importance of saving, but they absolutely do not have the patience that their parents had in terms of figuring out the landscape. And so that creates an opportunity, and that's really what Scriptbox is going after. Is, you know, how do you appeal to sort of the new generation of folks that want to feel like they're in charge of their saving options, but they want to have simple options that are easier to navigate and understand.
Is that the tutoring?
Right.
Is that the matching the tutor with
right.
the student, or is it really online tutor?
So it is online tutoring, but it really is just the marketplace. So if I do some local tutoring, I have a bit of a reputation. This platform allows me to now come online and start serving up a bigger market. So what the company does is it really just tries to be the marketplace for that. And again, there are variants of that in the ecosystem. There are folks that have a captive, you know, set of people that provide tutoring, and then some that are sort of completely.
How would they ever make money? Because the tutors are simply going to tell the parent, hey, like, next month onwards, give me the cash.
Right. You know, and so this is a traditional problem for all marketplaces, right? Any marketplace that drives repeated interactions with this sort of same two providers has to figure out how to create stickiness for those transactions to sort of continue. On that platform, right? And so obviously, many marketplaces will try and do this, but the more I invest and build a reputation, the easier I can start bumping up my price, the more business that sort of starts coming to me. And obviously, as a marketplace, you don't want to be too greedy about, you know, what you end up, you know, sort of thing. But a very, very legitimate concern.
Right,
but for instance, if a tutor is only doing very few sessions with a student, the platform sort of says, hey, this person doesn't seem to have stickiness, and therefore I'm automatically going to score them low. So now that tutor's ability to get future business from that platform gets compromised. I mean, again, it's not that they're beautiful solutions, but you have to.
Probably go on and not get too bogged down in one company.
I mean, again, because this is also the first time that enterprises are getting connected. It opens up opportunities for companies like Power to SME, which is now really. So today, for instance, if you had to buy, if you're a small buyer of aluminum, you could end up paying a 40%, 60% premium over a bulk buyer like a Tata or somebody. And that's really because you're paying for, in some cases, up to 5-6 levels of intermediaries that are making that whole transaction happen. So again, that creates opportunities for these marketplaces to emerge that can eliminate some of those.
So power to SME means small and medium-sized enterprise, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, okay.
And so this is really about, you know, the fact that in markets where information is a premium, SMEs have a big disadvantage,
yeah.
and that's really what their goal is.
So are pretty much all of these companies up to now primarily using smartphone platforms for interface?
A bulk of them.
Yeah.
In fact, there was this bit of a controversy, but sometime last year, Flipkart actually announced that they were going to stop their desktop app. So they were actually willing to let go of the small amount of traffic that they were seeing and really focus on being sort of mobile only. And it's funny, but this is now probably about 2-3 years ago. I was visiting one of my cousins, and his wife is sitting there, and she has her laptop open, and we're talking about some photos, right? And so she said, "Oh yeah, let me show you some photos that she'd posted on Facebook." And she whips out her phone and you know pulls up the photos. So I asked her that, "Oh, so you know you don't use Facebook or anything?" She said, "Well, I have once in a while." But so even for people that have access to laptops, because I think unlike us, where you know we spend a good chunk of our time, you know, with one of these close by, that's not really the case there.
So these are all companies on this page that are really looking at world markets early
on. Right. So this is a combination. So when we look at, for instance, companies like Freshdesk and Zenoti. So Freshdesk, again, I think there's a company called Zendesk, if some of you are familiar with that landscape. This is, you know, how do I create a cloud-based solution for a support team to operate? Now, one sort of challenge, I guess, for companies here to go public is that they have to start showing very large deal size, and it's just, you know, sort of an I think it's just an unfortunate sort of thing about what the market has kind of been trained to look for. But what happens is because of that, you end up with these solutions that can build a strong business in the SMB segment, but then at some point they feel the pressure to really go up, right? It's like, oh, you know, instead of, you know, trying to manage this churn and staying very cost efficient about how I acquire customers, it's so much easier to go win the multi-million dollar contracts upstream. And in the US, you know, I mean, you can, right? Because there are buyers who, you know, who are, you know, paying those large contracts. But I think that also opens up an opportunity for companies that really try and stay focused. Many of you might not have heard of this company, but it's a company called Zoho, which you know operates out of India. And it's funny, it's the number one company that we as a firm get pinged for by investors around the world, saying, "Hey, can you introduce us to Zoho?" Because Zoho has just built this phenomenal business without raising any money of building SMB products and being incredibly, incredibly focused on the cost structure around how you acquire customers, how you serve them, how you support them. So, for instance, the Freshdesk CEO is somebody that came out of Zoho, and you know, very, very much driven by the fact that he's seen this work, and so he's really now going after a certain class of those products for that SMB marketplace. Zenoti is a very smart chap, worked in the US for many years, worked at Microsoft, moved back to India, started managing his, I think it was his parents' spa business. And then he just realized that, you know, all the software out there to manage spas was horrible. And that there was this one market leader, MindBody, I think, which was cleaning up the market, but really was, you know, was not the best solution. So he said, well, you know, to hell with running the spa, he actually went out and started a company which is now displacing MindBody in a lot of US accounts. So. Very quickly, these couple of examples. For us, so if you think about the healthcare ecosystem, especially in this market, people that build expensive equipment to diagnose certain kinds of ailments, there is no real financial incentive for them to dramatically improve the cost structure of those. And in many cases, that creates an opportunity for somebody to build, you know, as technology improves, you can build dramatically cheaper solutions for that, and you can potentially sell them in emerging markets where, you know, folks are a lot more cost conscious, but then eventually bring them back into Western markets. So we actually have two investments. One, which is really about combining the top four eye exams into a single machine, and in fact, it's almost portable, so it's very easy to even lug that machine around. We have another one which is focused on robotic arms for biopsies, and if you think about when this problem was originally solved, you know, high precision robotics was at a premium. Image analysis for guided navigation was a very hard problem. And so the folks that build those initial machines, you know, they charge an arm and a leg for them, and they haven't bothered bringing down those prices. And so suddenly you have this company where, you know, bulk of the work is being done out of India. They're building solutions that are dramatically lower in cost, but then they have that whole market opportunity to go after. Mitra is an example of something that's, you know, much more of a software-driven platform that now allows you to deal with a lot of data sets that help you look at more personalized solutions for cancer. So that's really what I had. I mean, this is just sort of an example of, I mean, you know, fundamentally, most of our consumer-facing portfolio really is, you know, is mobile heavy. I mean, these were, you know, slightly unique models. You know, we talked about MoneyView, which really allows you to sort of create the mint-like view, but purely by SMS traffic. India is still very heavily a prepaid market, so which means that your cell phone, you actually don't pay for it on a monthly basis. You actually go and you put in some money, and then you keep using it till you run out of money. Now, the ability to track how much money is left, and, you know, and especially with these data apps, do I have apps that are now suddenly chewing up more of my data, you know, becomes very key. And so, you know, we now have solutions that really focus on helping the user keep track of that. And you know, folks obviously love these kinds of apps. English, those, I mean, this is an, it's a mobile solution that's focused on teaching you how to speak English. So, you know, for a lot of jobs in India, it's not so much about reading and writing skills, but if you can improve, you know, so for instance, if you think about taxi drivers and restaurants, a lot of these places where the ability to speak some English dramatically improves your employability. And so that's an app that's focused on that piece. I mean, this is really more of a, think of it as a, you know, word of caution, right? You know, obviously, there was this joke that, you know, for a while, there were two types of people, I mean, two types of investors, right? People who made money in China and therefore wanted to make money in India, and then people who missed out making money in China and did not want to miss out making money in India. But you have to be careful, right? You know, yes, you know, smartphones are now smartphone penetration is going up quite a bit, but that's not the only factor, right? You know, I mean, how quickly does disposable income grow? What kinds of things do people end up choosing to sort of spend that on? A lot of those will really define how quickly some of these opportunities can scale. And if you look at what happened. In terms of the slowdown, I mean, that's really what happened. You know, you suddenly had this influx of global capital into India, and then, you know, sort of China sneezed, right? And everybody sort of realized, hey, if I was making the assumption that I'm going to walk out of India in 3 years with big bags of money, you know, I really have to sort of question that. And so that's, you know, yes, it's a promising story, but you still have to be careful. Yeah, so I think that's all I had. Happy to
okay.
answer.
That's fabulous. Thank you, Dinesh. So we do have some time for questions. I'd like to ask a couple of questions to kind of get things going. So for a long time, India was a great place to do software development because of labor cost advantage. Are you seeing kind of labor cost advantage as less a factor in setting up a company now, or what?
Yeah.
How's that?
Absolutely, right? I mean, I think there is still a bit of a cost advantage, but when we look at investing in companies, again, we have to be very careful that, in the initial journey of a startup, your software development cost might be a reasonable sort of chunk of the overall cost, but that, very, very soon, that actually becomes a small piece. And for instance, if you're building a global product, sales and marketing and having a presence in these markets is really going to become the big driver. So the way we
so it's really
look at
growth
it,
of the market, growth of the India market that's now becoming more of a driver. You're seeing the rise of India-only business models and so forth.
Right, absolutely. But I think one thing that we do like is, for instance, we have an investment in a company that does recurring payments. Now, today, if you build some solution here, and you put it out on the web, even without you doing a whole lot of advertising, you might have buyers coming in from Ukraine, and they come to your site, and they try to buy your product, and then it turns out that their particular payment solution or their credit card doesn't work. So what this company does is, they're not saying, hey, our engineers are cheaper, but what they're saying is that I can build a product where I can integrate with the payment gateways in lots and lots of countries. And the funny thing is, if I'm looking for a payment gateway that operates in Eastern Europe, it's very likely that somebody in an Infosys or a Wipro, in fact, has experience working on that gateway. So it's a way of translating that availability into a real competitive advantage as opposed
okay.
to sort of...
Next question. How does your team find the companies in India? Is it really becoming easier to find companies? There are a lot of startup kind of gatherings and slush kind of events or whatever.
Right. So this is before I became part of the team, but the team in India started off 10 years ago as really a very small early stage fund. And this was, the ecosystem was not as vibrant, entrepreneurship was still sort of beginning to happen. And the fact that this was a team of people that actually had been entrepreneurs before helped them with that initial sort of buzz. Over the years, we've seen a lot more things beginning to fall in place. So now we have a lot more angel money, incubators, accelerators. Most of the models that you see here have cropped up in India as well. It's still not as efficient and as vibrant, and you still have bad apples in the ecosystem, but sort of growing pains.
No, we have those here, right? So what are the big challenges for people that want to start a company or that are interested in being an entrepreneur?
Right. So, a couple of things, right? I think especially for folks that are here and are considering being entrepreneurs in India, it is a slightly different operating landscape. And I think having some familiarity with that landscape, or having people on the team that have familiarity actually helps. Also, I think you can't approach it with too much naivete that, because this worked elsewhere, therefore it should work here. Unfortunately, there are a lot of these sort of local challenges that do need to get sort of addressed. So sometimes, we see, folks really confident about just taking some model and very quickly cloning it. And in fact, sometimes we see folks that want to clone it even without coming to India. So, they want to run a India opportunity-focused startup while still living elsewhere.
What about young people in India? Is it a more friendly environment now, say, than 10 years ago, if you want to start a company?
Yes, absolutely. So the joke was, 10, 15 years ago, nobody would marry you if you worked in a startup, right? And whereas, whereas now, this is, 2005, so I'm the CEO of a company that has offices in Bombay and Bangalore, and one day I'm visiting there. And I see this, you know, old, you know, couple walking across. And so sometime later, I was asking, oh, you know, who are those? And it turns out that there was this woman that wanted to join us. But her parents were, you know, what is this company? I've never heard of it. And, you know, you have an offer from Siemens, you know, which everybody's heard of. And so the parents actually wanted to come to the office to make sure that this was a, you know, legit operation and their, you know, poor daughter wasn't being conned by some con artist, right? But I think, and partly some of the activity over the last couple of years has really helped make this be a, you know, bit more legitimate.
Yeah, no, because what you say, a few years ago, we had a person who was talking about India, and we got into the Q&A, and the person said, I'm spending at least, you know, a third of my time convincing parents that it's okay for their children to start companies. One more thing, and then I'll let the floor have questions. You didn't talk much about exits. What's happening about the exit potentials in India?
Right. So in fact, you know, in that whole word of caution, that really is probably one of the biggest concern areas, right? So if you look at, I mean, in markets like the US, M&A and IPOs end up really providing exit opportunities, whereas in India, both those markets are still not really well developed. And so that's something you have to be very watchful about. I mean, you can't be very optimistic about how soon those things happen. You know, I mean, we see promising signs on both fronts, but mm-hmm. you know, still long journeys to get there.
Is that motivating companies to come here?
Well, so it is motivating, you know, even for folks like us, the fact that part of our portfolio is really going after a global marketplace. Mm-hmm. I mean, in some ways, it also offers, at least for some of those companies, exit opportunities that, you know, are richer and broader than the ones that
exist. Have you had any flips where the company creates a U.S. subsidiary that then buys out the original company?
Yeah, yes. Unfortunately,
we've had to deal with that.
Do that as well.
Okay, let's open the floor to questions. Way back in the back.
See how cultural differences play in entrepreneurship in places like China and Japan. So, like, as a foreigner going to India, what kind of differences would, like, someone like me not expect?
Well, you know, now, I can't speak to the sort of specific differences, but I think you have to be prepared for a lot of differences, right? But also, one thing that I would say. So again, my colleagues who started investing, 10 plus years ago, one of the interesting comments they made was, you know, when they started, you would see a reasonable amount of misrepresentation in business plans, right? And you know, people would come and make claims. That, you know, when you dug in, actually, you know, turned out to be lies. But one of the good things they say is that it's not that it's halved now. He said it's virtually disappeared. So today, a lot of, you know, the whole new generation of entrepreneurs, I mean, they don't see the need to be stretching the truth in you know, sort of very. I mean, again, you still have the sort of bad apples, but the rate at which it's gone away is phenomenally encouraging. So I think we're certainly seeing within this sort of startup ecosystem in the tech world a level of professionalism that's coming in very, very rapidly. So to me, that's and for many people, that's been a bit of a surprise, right? Sort of folks that worked in this ecosystem several years ago and have now had reason to go and work with it again. You know, a lot of them feel that difference. But you know, I mean, obviously, you know, culturally, infrastructure-wise, you know, a lot of things that you'd have to be wary about.
Yeah, let's move around first. Meg, I saw your hand next.
Okay, I have two questions. The first one is, do you think American companies are doing well in India? Like, it's, so far as I observed, I think like LinkedIn, they're really well localized. For example, they start like, not only for recruiting for jobs, but also they started dating like services in India, or they're launching. Okay. That's I heard. And also Facebook, they like FB Start, which is a really new initiative to encourage entrepreneurs in India. And also Amazon, they put tons of money on human resources to hire bilingual. So I wonder, do you think they're really doing well in India?
You know, so I think in that sense, the Indian market is in some ways a fairer market in the sense that you know, you don't get much advantage by being a local provider of something equivalent, right? So the Facebook of India is Facebook, the LinkedIn of India is LinkedIn. So a lot of these models that actually work in that geography do in fact end up having an opportunity to win that space because the local market doesn't just give an automatic advantage to somebody that's a local provider. So because of that, you know, we've seen a lot of these brands, you know, go in and get active. I do think that the enterprise buyer market in India still has you know, some way to go. You know, we see some of the top you know, well-known brands do well, but I think if you're not a well-known brand in India, you know, it's still a bit of a struggle to really get the enterprise buyers there to sort of make that step. And we see that with our own portfolio companies, you know, so the same portfolio company that's trying to sell within India and trying to sell to enterprises here in some ways gets a fairer shot here.
So I saw various hands. I saw your hand, and then your hand, and then your hand, okay? So one, two, three.
Well, one of the quick reasons I was wondering is one of the reasons it's stabilizing because the smartphone affords more informational transparency so that you can eliminate a lot of these. Like you mentioned before, someone would do a transaction, try to buy something, and then maybe never know if it would come through or it would be a lie. Is that just because now I have a smartphone and if I get, you know, shafted or something, I can turn around and tweet about it to everybody? I mean, what has made it more stable?
Right.
Or,
no.
Like, just the fact that you said before people bought a phone, and yet half of them wouldn't even be connected.
Yeah.
Is there now an infrastructure where everyone just has access to that connectivity or that transfer?
Right.
What changed?
Right. So connectivity has, of course, become much more affordable. And because, you know, now people, as soon as they buy a smartphone, they want to make sure that their WhatsApp starts working and they can see, you know, photos that are being sent. I mean, they have enough incentive to get the data plan in place, to learn how to get an app onto the phone. But then you now start discovering all of these sort of other apps. But more importantly, you know, I think it's because there weren't that many offline organized ways. So really, it's just, this really is the first way in which for a lot of these things you have information access for the first time, as opposed to having to deal with an individual that might only be able to provide you with a limited, you know, set of options for whatever it is that you were trying to do.
Just real briefly, for those of you who've been following the series, Hans Tung made very similar point in China,
mm-hmm.
that one of the reasons online e-commerce was doing so well in China is because the traditional retail industry was fragmented and really hard to get things done. And so this is really a much, you know, a real improvement in people's daily lives.
Right. So you invested in India, right, for 2 years? Or what, right? Were you in India? No. Okay, sorry.
Go ahead. You're next.
So one of your themes was software for the world. So my question is, are most of the companies in that area, like, are they thinking global first or India first, and then What sets them apart? Like, why are they coming out of India and not somewhere else?
Yeah. No. So a couple of things. I think in most cases they are beginning to think global first as opposed to local. Partly because I think we're now many of these companies are discovering that to get true product market fit, you really have to operate in a market where the buyer takes you through, you know, sort of the ringer. And so you want good, sophisticated buyers. And I mean, right now, and for the last several years, I mean, the U.S. really is the best early adopter market. So in terms of anybody that's having to try and find product market fit, they realize that, you know, you want to have conversations in this market. I think most entrepreneurs now, at least on the enterprise side, you know, it's not about here is a customer pain and I've figured out a solution, and now I just have to, you know, market it and sell it. The whole notion of really finding good product market fit means solving for efficient ways in which that product finds its way into the hands of, you know, somebody who's going to use it. So in our case, you know, we definitely encourage all of our companies that have global ambitions to really use that. In fact, you know, we've set up a bit of an incubation space here in Silicon Valley, so a lot of our teams can actually start coming here and
but can I drill down on this? So, okay, US is a great early adopter market,
yeah.
But why are the companies being registered in India to start with?
Right. So In many cases, in our portfolio, companies that are that are, have global ambitions are being registered in the U.S. or in Singapore.
Okay.
And you know, it's just sort of a bit unfortunate that the current regulatory challenges.
Well, the immigration challenges.
It turns out that even
not it.
Sure, please, please. I know there are people in this room who know a lot more about this, so please chime in.
I have a number of questions, but I'll save that for later, but correct a few things. I just stepped out.
Okay, I have to say that probably this is not going to go out on the TV feed, whatever you say.
It's a good idea then.
Okay. So be patient, everybody, on TV.
I'm going to share some information which I used to be the head of NASCOM, not head of policy for NASCOM, which is the Association of the IT Industry, which represents 95%. And I'm here as a visiting scholar for a couple of months at Stanford. I'm old PhD from here. So just to answer a few questions about, including yours, there's a structural change occurring in the industry. So you really need to think about the Indian software and the IT-enabled services differently. In fact, NASCOM itself has restructured. So their flagship now is 10,000 startups over the next 5 years, which they're promoting. So there's
and
more
as you mentioned, NASCOM is clearly one of the most visible forces.
Here,
so.
For example, at Iconto, one of the things they do is success. We have competitions that bring them over here, things like that. But so, question one, are the foreign companies making money? There are two types, you have to separate them. And I'm talking not just American. Those who are serving the Indian market, they have traditionally done very well. And if you look historically at the Bureau of Economic Analysis of the US, that India has always been in one of the more profitable markets, especially in areas like, think of Hindustan, Lever, etc. Other companies use India as a platform. They're doing fantastically well. Part of my job was when all these CEOs would come, I'd be trotted out and I'd give them the, no BS saying what were the tough questions, but they're doing fantastically well, and the big reason is talent acquisition. They find it easy, but they find now the bigger cities. So they're going to the second one. Shell, I used to be chief economist of Shell, the big bad oil company at one time. They've decided to have the global technology center in there because IP is protected, et cetera, et cetera. So you have to keep those things separate. The question that I'm sorry you asked earlier, which
about
is...
About why register in India, or a different question?
Yeah, so on this one, I just completed a study just for myself after stepping down on intellectual property in India. And we interviewed startups and big boys and small boys, so four categories of companies. The behavior is very different. And for example, most of these, as you might have gathered, the intellectual property that is being produced is non-patentable, most cases. There are a few, like Forrest. We have got a case study of Forrest. But there are others who are protected. Now, why are they deciding to relocate and register in America or in Singapore? It's actually basically we thought we had some problems with our intellectual property regime, which we're going to try to fix. But it turns out it's not that. It's just a question of valuation. The investors say that reputational effects, if your patent is registered in Singapore or in the US, we get much better valuations. Secondly, there is a question of exiting. A lot of the companies register in Mauritius, which is biggest foreign investor in India is Mauritius. But that's because a lot of it is round tripping.
We'll go back to the Panama Papers.
But I have lots. Yeah. But some of these things, so you can get confused about the Indian industry. This is there are thousands now of startups, and they are concentrated mainly in Bangalore, but a few in Mumbai and a few in Delhi. But they are going to be a volatile ride, I'm sure you, which I will talk to you later about. Because right now, Flipkart, for example, the valuations have come down, but it's not surprising. It's not necessarily bad news. I think it's more of people recognizing the bubbly aspects.
You had a question too, right?
I have more, but I think it'll bore everybody.
Okay.
More technical.
Okay. We'll move on then. Go ahead.
So quickly, of the things you mentioned, what are some of the kind of, let's say, less visible but highly underserved areas that are good opportunities? I mean, everybody is in food delivery, and everybody has learned their lesson. everybody wants to use e-commerce.
I mean, one thing I should point out, right? I mean, if you look at a lot of what happened, you know, over the last 12 to 18 months, right? I mean, there's maybe about these sort of 30-ish business models where people have seen that model scale in other markets, and so, you know, there was this kind of rapid, you know, so you could be the fourth or fifth player in food delivery, and you know, somebody, I mean, because I mean essentially these are all portfolio bets, right? So if somebody is betting on the Indian consumer story, then a lot of them come in with that thing that, hey, you know, there's 30 models I'm comfortable with, you know, depending on my pool of money, I'm going to, you know, at least invest in 10, or I'm going to invest in 5, or I'm going to invest in 20. And so that's really what, you know, a lot of what happened last year was, you know, a lot of momentum behind that. That's one. It is funny. One, you know, one reporter was asking our team in India. So, oh, are you guys going to go back to doing enterprise investments? And he says, well, you know, you never reported about our enterprise investments last year. You know, we actually did a bunch. So I think it's just that there's a lot of attention on those sort of categories. But in general, I mean, you know, there are certain themes that we look at. But I'd probably say, you know, half of our investments really come from themes that we are sort of proactively believers in. But then there's the other half is really where, you know, some entrepreneur or some team has really gone and really uncovered, you know, models that need fixing and have figured out ways of fixing it. And if we think that there's a good technology-led way of you know, approaching that, you know, I mean, we know nothing about intercity and intracity trucking, but when a team comes and really explains to us what are the current challenges and how they're going to sort of take a dent, then we get in.
So let me make a plug for a couple of weeks from today. We've got our session on social entrepreneurship coming up on May 24th, and we'll have one person talking about the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, and another person who's the CEO of the Bombay Hemp Company is going to come and talk. So this should be an interesting kind of take on different market sectors, right? Bottom of the pyramid and things that are really kind of either nonprofit or for benefit corporations. You had a question.
Yes. So my question is, you know, with Flipkart and all of these e-commerce companies, are you seeing a lot of cross-border commerce, both into India and outside?
Right. So, in fact, you know, we just talked about some of these areas where we do have a thesis. One of our theses is, in fact, cross-border commerce, and we think that the friction to doing business across international boundaries is going to come down. And so we have investments in that space. We have one investment. Well, you're familiar with it. Anita is a longtime entrepreneur as well. But this is really something that looks at you know, international commerce. Today, for me to ship something internationally, I have to worry about how do I categorize it, how do I figure out duties, how do I meet all the compliance requirements to be an exporter, to be an importer in that country. So this is a solution that really packages all of that into an API that's sort of really easy to use. We have investments in India. So for instance, there are folks that have the rights to distribute products in certain geographies, but some of those geographies, they might not exercise those rights because you didn't have good organized offline retail options. So much like what Myntra did specifically for fashion, we have an investment that's focused on really a broader set of goods where folks might have the ability to sell that in India, but they're just focused on the opportunity in Hong Kong and Singapore and those more lucrative markets. So can they actually, you know, become an aggregator for that and sell them into India? And it's an area where we continue to look for opportunities. So cross-border commerce, I think, is very much an area of focus.
So let me ask kind of the last question. A few years ago when we were talking about what's going on in India, most of the venture capital was really coming from outside of India. Mm-hmm. Are you seeing the growth of domestic wealth in India from successful entrepreneurs that's really making a purely domestic play, or is it still largely kind of worldwide?
So if you look at, for instance, the angel ecosystem, that's now really, really flooded with a lot of domestic participants. You know, in some sort of, you know, regulatory things that need to be smoothed out, but you know, clearly that whole vibrancy is there. I think on the larger funds, I'd probably say maybe it's still a lot more driven by global investors. Mm-hmm. But we're again certainly seeing that class grow.
Okay.
So I think it's venture capital has become a legitimate sort of thing, as opposed to, you know.
It's amazing growth for the last couple of years. Anyway, we have some refreshments outside, and like to encourage everybody to stay around and get to know each other and talk more with Dinesh. First of all, please join me again in thanking Dinesh for a great presentation.
No, thank you. Absolutely. Pleasure being here.